If you've ever searched the internet for anything related to real estate or home ownership, things like how to buy a house, how to build passive income, or how to become a millionaire, no doubt a short time later you were inundated with ads upon ads about how to build your wealth from the ground up.
We're gonna talk about how I've made millions of dollars using two secret strategies.
Fake gurus with online courses and get-rich-quick schemes.
Here in my garage, just bought this new Lamborghini.
Telling you that all you really need is a better work ethic, a shift in mindset, and the information hidden behind their $2,000 paywall.
Rich people don't sleep 8 hours a day.
Sure, no doubt, work ethic, mindset, and financial literacy all play a part in building wealth. But in order for any of that to matter, we've got to pull back the curtains and look at the true rules of the game we've all been forced to play. And before we even start to talk about real estate and home ownership as tools to build wealth, let us never forget just how important safe housing is to livelihood itself. This video is dedicated to Alua Toyin Salau, a 19-year-old who should be here right now. But instead, after weeks of battling homelessness, as well as being a vocal advocate for the Black Lives Matter movement, she was sexually assaulted and murdered in Tallahassee, Florida. May she rest in peace. In order to get an understanding of how housing and property ownership work in the U.S., we're going back to June 19, 1865. You may recognize this day as the holiday known as Juneteenth, a particularly salient starting point given the global outcry around the Black Lives Matter movement and the even more recent outcry around Donald Trump's campaign rally that was, until recently, set to take place not just on Juneteenth, but just steps away from the former site of Black Wall Street, which is where one of the worst race massacres in our nation's history took place. We'll talk about that event more soon. On June 19, 1865, Union soldiers arrived in Galveston, Texas. They brought with them General Order No. 3, which read, in part, "The people of Texas are informed that in accordance with a proclamation from the Executive of the United States, all slaves are free." Note that this was 2.5 years, a full 901 days after the Emancipation Proclamation was signed. And to provide a context that I think is missing for many, this was just 155 years ago, a point that was driven home for me when on a visit to my 81-year-old grandmother, she, having been born just 74 years after those soldiers arrived in Texas, told me stories she'd been told by her grandmother, stories that told tale of preparing food for Klan rallies and fleeing the plantation in the dead of the night. But whatever the reason for the delay between the Emancipation Proclamation and June 19th, Juneteenth has ever since been a celebrated day representing joy, resilience, and freedom. The same year that news of freedom reached Texas, there was a meeting between Union General William Sherman and 20 Black community leaders. The former enslaved were asked in what manner they thought they could best assist and take care of themselves in order to maintain their freedom. Their answer? To have land, to turn it and till it by our own labor, and soon we can maintain ourselves and have something to spare. The ability to own property has always been a key factor in being able to protect and provide for oneself. In what was called Special Order No. 15, General Sherman declared that 400,000 acres of land in South Carolina, Georgia, and Florida would be split into 40-acre plots and, along with the mule, be given to those recently free Black families. And in my research, I was even able to find a property deed from 1865. It granted a man named Richard Brown 40 acres of land on what had previously been a plantation. But things would quickly change. Less than a year later, with President Abraham Lincoln having been assassinated and President Andrew Johnson now in power, Special Fields Order No. 15 was reversed. And although 40,000 families had already moved onto that land, the land was confiscated and they were forcibly removed. 56 years later, in 1921, some of those Black families had relocated throughout the expanding U.S. Many of them landed in Oklahoma, a state that was just 14 years old at the time. That land, which had seen near genocide and the loss of a quarter of the Cherokee population on the Trail of Tears, was now home to a booming population of 100,000 people, many of whom were enjoying the fruits of newly discovered oil fields. Almost 10,000 of those people were residents of the community of Greenwood, known fondly as Black Wall Street, and less fondly by the white residents of Tulsa as Little Africa. The neighborhood of Greenwood contained dozens of Black-owned businesses, including barbershops, grocery stores, photography studios, a movie theater, and more than a dozen churches. But on May 31st of 1921, this would all change. 19-year-old Dick Rowland was making his way to an elevator in the building next to where he worked in order to access a colored restroom. The most reported story is that as he got into the elevator, he tripped, bumping into 17-year-old white teenager Sarah Page, and she screamed. Her screams attracted the attention of a nearby clerk who, despite the fact that Sarah Page never pressed charges, concluded that Dick Rowland must have been trying to rape her, and he was taken into custody at the local county jail. But Tulsa, as well as many other cities around the U.S., had a problem with white mobs kidnapping and lynching Black prisoners. After the local newspaper made a call for white Tulsans to nab Negro for attacking girl in elevator, a mob formed outside the county jail with intentions to do just that. armed men from Greenwood arrived to guard the jail. A scuffle broke out between them and the mob, a gunshot rang out, and one of the worst race massacres in our nation's history began. Through the night and another full day, the neighborhood known as Black Wall Street was invaded, looted, bombed from airplanes, and burned to the ground. As the mob moved through Greenwood, Black residents were forced to fight or flee. By the time the National Guard arrived and got the violence under control, the majority of Black Tulsans had either escaped into the countryside, been killed, or rounded up in internment camps by white citizens and police alike, where they needed someone who was white to vouch for them in order to get out over the next week. Some were even forced to dig mass graves for the more than 300 Black Tulsans killed. And despite stories of these mass graves persisting for years, it was only recently that the community was able to get assurance from the city that they would give these victims proper recognition and burial. But even after being released from internment camps, there wasn't much to go back to. Nearly all of the remaining Black residents of Tulsa were now homeless. And despite efforts by the American Red Cross, many of them would spend the winter of 1921 living in tents next to the charred remains of their former homes. In the end, more than 300 Black Tulsans were killed. More than 40 square blocks of 1,260 homes and 150 hospitals, schools, businesses, and churches were destroyed. The Black community filed $4 million in claims, which would be over $57 million today. All of their claims were denied. Today, the Greenwood Cultural Center, which describes itself as the keeper of the flame for the Black Wall Street era, as well as the John Hope Franklin Reconciliation Park, pay homage to this bloody chapter in American history. In the 99 years since Black Wall Street was bombed and burned, it's clear that the gap between people of color and white Americans has only grown larger. And while minorities have largely been excluded from safe housing and wealth building, I would also argue that the vast majority of Americans have been excluded from these things as well. Let's take a look at the numbers. In 1989, the top 1% of Americans held 29% of the wealth in the country. In 2016, that number had grown to 38.5% with no slowdown in sight. Even if we look just at white Americans, the richest 10% hold 75% of the wealth. And what's more, if wealth in white families was just held stagnant, not decreased, but just kept at the same level, it would still take 228 years for wealth in black families to catch up at the current pace. As you can probably imagine, it's even worse when we look along lines of gender. For women in general, but especially women of color, whose wealth is equal to pennies on the dollar of that of their white male counterparts. But how are we even defining wealth? In America, 2/3 of all wealth is held in the form of home equity. As time goes on, housing values increase or appreciate, and that builds up the amount of equity in the house. That equity can be taken out in the form of cash when a home is sold, or through financial instruments such as home equity loans, as well as increased access to credit and tax benefits. Even after years of redlining, where federal programs like the FHA forbid banks from giving black families home loans, while at the same time holding home values in black neighborhoods artificially low, the Fair Housing Act of 1968 has not made much of a difference, as the vast majority of people living in America are still unable to take part in the wealth-building world of home ownership. With tens of millions of people unemployed, either without housing or with skyrocketing rents, and multi-million dollar corporations buying up housing and building new properties at head-spinning rates, the ability to actually use your work ethic and knowledge to build wealth is quickly being stomped out. One of the biggest barriers we face lies in credit reporting. Access to credit is one of the key indicators of how much wealth a person will be able to build over their lifetime. And in the current system, rent, cell phone, and utility payments are not incorporated into the models that determine who can get a home loan. Just including these things as a standard part of the process would drastically increase the likelihood of home ownership for the more than 60% of people under 35 who are still renting. And that's not to say that renting is bad, or that everyone who is renting would want to buy a home, but to be systemically locked out of one of the key drivers of wealth is unjust any way you look at it. Another key issue is our tax system and who it benefits. In the past 20 years, the federal government has spent $8 trillion on programs designed to help families build wealth. This spending has focused on helping people save for retirement, buy homes, start businesses, and accrue higher education. But unfortunately, the real-life result is that the typical millionaire gets $145,000 worth of public tax benefits when the average family gets a grand total of $174. So aside from either leading or supporting initiatives like the ones I've linked in the description below, what can we do to put our hard work and ambition to good use? While I don't have all the answers, it's a journey that I'm documenting through this channel and that I invite you to join me on. For me, it started with gaining knowledge of these systems and finding ways to use them to the advantage of those they were designed to exclude. The same government program that was responsible for the redlining of black neighborhoods is the same program I used to purchase a duplex to house hack, where I live in one side and rent out the other. I also took advantage of a state-funded program to get thousands of dollars paid towards my down payment, And what I'm most proud of is that that duplex is just blocks away from where Black Wall Street stood. I know buying one property will neither close the racial wealth gap nor make me a millionaire, but I do think it's one of the first steps that many of us can take to lowering our living expenses as well as building wealth through home ownership. I'll be posting videos every Tuesday, Friday, and Sunday to help educate us all on the world and financial systems around us and what we can do to make sure that our hard work and ambition can actually take us where we want to go. If you'd like to be a part of that journey, I invite you to subscribe. And if you made it this far in the video, I give you my most sincere thanks. In the description, you can find links to other videos I've done on finances and real estate, as well as links that will take you to the work of brilliant people who are in the fight daily to make this world a more just place. Thank you for watching.